Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Okay, good. Want to make sure some people are here. Welcome to the National Federation of the Blind, Jernigan Institute. My name is Mark Riccobono. I'm president of the National Federation of the Blind. I'd like to welcome you tonight to this mayoral debate. It's a pleasure for us to host this event. The National Federation of the Blind is a nationwide civil rights organization of blind people. And we work on raising expectations for blind people because we recognize that low expectations create obstacles between blind people and our dreams. And we know that blindness does not hold us back and that we can live the lives we want. So we train blind people, we empower blind people to be active in all aspects of society. And as an individual who was elected by a constituency, I know the great honor of serving as a representative leader. In my case, I serve as president of the National Federation of the Blind, having been elected at our national convention. We believe in the political process. We believe in the process of having people talk about what their hopes and dreams are and having people be able to ask questions. I was just telling some of the candidates that the National Federation of the Blind is a nationwide organization. We made this our national headquarters in 1978. We started investing in Baltimore by buying this entire city square block for $532,000. Sounds like a great investment, right? We put many, many more millions of dollars into this city square block, and we have 75 employees here now, and we're here to stay. This is our national headquarters, and we bring thousands of people through Baltimore from all over the nation and all over the world to learn about what we do on a nationwide basis. And we're very proud to be located here in South Baltimore, and we're very proud to be part of the fabric of society here in Baltimore and that we've been so welcome. So we welcome you to our home, and we look forward to this evening's events. I do want to recognize this evening, first of all, our moderator for the evening, Tom Hall from WYPR. Thank you, Tom, for being here. I extend our appreciation to the six neighborhood associations that have partnered on this event this evening. The Federal Hill Neighborhood Association, the Federal Hill South Neighborhood Association, the Key Highway Community Association, the Locust Point Civic Association, the Riverside Neighborhood, where we are right here, and my very own neighborhood, the South Baltimore Neighborhood Association. So thank you for all of our community leaders who are here. We also appreciate the League of Women Voters, who has partnered with us on this event this evening. Absolutely. The League of Women Voters of Baltimore City has done a great job helping us put this together. And I want now to turn the floor over to our representative there. I was asking her about her title. Her title is co-president. I said, I've never heard of a co-president. She said, well, you know, when you're a volunteer and you do as much work as we do, you got to have a co-president. I appreciate that very much and certainly appreciate that she puts all of this work to raise civic appreciation and participation as a volunteer. Here's the co-president of the League of Women Voters of Baltimore City, Linda Riddleman.
To the rules for this evening, but before I do, I want to point out that we have a registration table in the back there where you can register to vote. I assume most of you work, all of you are. And to remind you that the felony voter law was overridden and takes effect March 10th. If you're so inclined, we'd be happy to register you to vote this evening, and we'll hang on to that registration, and I'll walk them down to the Baltimore City Board of Elections myself on March 10th. Also to remind you that if you need to change your address, we can do that tonight. If you need to change your party affiliation, so you can vote April 26th, we can do that tonight. Maryland is a closed primary state. You can only vote in the Republican or Democratic race that you are registered for. So if you wish to change that affiliation so you can vote for somebody other than the judges, we can take care of that for you tonight. You can always change back after. The rules for this evening, and Tom's going to follow up with some moderation notes he has. Please, first of all, turn off your cell phones or at least silence them. No recording or flash photography is permitted. You can take still photos, that's fine. And I should point out that this event will be live streamed this evening thanks to cityexplainer.com and southbmore.com. So you can look for it afterwards. We thank them very much for their support. No campaign banners, signs, clothing, buttons, literature handouts, or other campaign paraphernalia are allowed in the building. We ask you that you refrain from applauding or in other ways demonstrating support or non-support for a candidate. There will be no audience reaction shots during the debate, although panning of the audience before and after the debate may be allowed. We have determined tonight's order, taking the first questions and their seating assignments by lot. And I'll let Tom, the candidates will have 90 seconds to introduce themselves. They will have 90 seconds to respond to a question, and they will have 30 seconds a rebuttal. I'll be at the table here performing the timekeeping where they can see me, and I'll let Tom describe the way the questions are going to run.
Thank you, Linda, and welcome to everybody. Welcome to the candidates. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to the folks here at the National Federation for the Blind for hosting us. Thanks for everybody who is joining us online. The questions that I will ask you, ladies and gentlemen, have been developed by the six neighborhood associations that are cooperating with the NFB and the League of Women Voters in this event. Plus, we will have some questions from members of the audience who will be filling out cards and some of all the events. Those cards will be brought to me during the course of the proceedings, which we hope to conclude at about 8:45 or so. That's our target. As you can see on the stage, ladies and gentlemen, we have 11 candidates. We are expecting Senator Pugh shortly. So we are going to divide you into two groups. The first six candidates and then the second group of the second five candidates. As Linda mentioned, those candidates in the order that they sit has been determined randomly by drawing of straws backstage. Each of you will be have a chance to answer each question. The way we'll do this is as follows. I will ask the first question of the first six candidates, and then we will have, and each of those candidates will have a minute and 30 seconds to respond. Then we will ask the second five candidates if they would like to respond as well and rebut anything they've heard any of the other candidates say for a period of 30 seconds. We'll go back to the original group, and if you have anything additional that you would like to say, you will also have 30 seconds. You are not required to respond and rebut every time, but if you'd like to, you'll be given the opportunity to do that. Each candidate will start with an opening statement. We did change things a little bit from what Linda just announced. We'll have you speak for a minute in your opening statement and a minute and 30 seconds in your closing statement. And we will ask again that your closing statement not reference anything that anyone has said this evening, but rather that you concentrate on your own candidacy and your own reasons for wanting to be the Democratic nominee for mayor. So we will begin with an opening statement from each candidate. We will begin with Councilman Nick Mosey.
In 50 years, children from Cherry Hill to Reservoir Hill to right here in Federal Hill will have the opportunity of knowing exactly what we are as a city. This is a defining moment for our city. A defining moment to say that we will make our government accountable to taxpayers. That we will make our government accountable to driving better schools for our children. That we will make our government accountable to protecting the sanctity of our communities. This is a defining moment, a moment that we haven't had in a very long time. It's a time for us to connect the dots of the challenges that have plagued our city for far too long. And with my unique background of being born and raised, seeing the best, but also seeing the worst of this city, working through city government in the past 5 years and seeing the deficiencies, but not long enough to allow them to cloud my judgment, it is time for us to come together to drive a collective spirit for a better change of Baltimore. Please vote for me, Nick Mosby, Mosby for Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman. Our next speaker is Patrick Gutierrez. He's a former Bank of America Vice President and Operations Manager.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Patrick Gutierrez, and I'm running for mayor because, as the father of two young daughters, I want a better city for them and everyone who lives here. And like so many other people living here, I am fed up with the way our city has been run. We deserve better. The office of the mayor has the responsibility to set the example for how the entire city is going to be viewed. And previous mayors have set a very low bar. I want to raise that bar for all of us. As an operations manager, I specialize in turning around poor performing operations. And when I look over at City Hall, I see many of the same problems that I was hired to fix. Poor leadership and poor management of our employees, our processes, and our money have cost our city dearly. It's time to change that. It's time to start getting results. Please vote for me, Patrick Gutierrez, for mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Our next speaker is Cindy Walsh. She is an academic researcher.
Hello, everyone. My campaign is probably the most different of all the others. I have a vision. It's different. Currently, we have a master plan that sees Baltimore as an international economic zone with global corporate campuses, global corporate factories, and a center that's for the foreign rich. My vision is to rebuild the communities that exist for the people who are here, making them attractive enough to bring new citizens, and to keep the idea of an international zone away. We want to be a sovereign city, a state, and a sovereign nation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Walsh. Our next candidate is Duran McKesson. He's the co-founder of Campaign Zero.
I'm here tonight running to be the next mayor of Baltimore because I believe in the power and promise of the city. I grew up in the city, I love this city, and in that love, I also know the challenges of our city, like you. And if we're to meet those challenges head on, if we're to find a new way for the city, we have to take a new path. And if we don't, if the establishment is what we choose, if the familiar is who we choose, we know what we're going to get because we're living in it. My name is Duran McKesson, and I'm not beholden to the establishment. I'm an activist, educator, and organizer who knows what it means to put forth a vision to put the right people in the right place and follow that vision through to execution. I believe in a city that works for people, a city where students go to school in safe environments, where people have jobs, and they can support their families, and where the police serve, protect, and respect each citizen. Tonight's conversation has to be a conversation about concrete things that we can do to make people's lives better today and tomorrow. It has to be about real things and real solutions because people's lives hang in the balance. I'm excited to be here tonight. I'm ready to start this conversation.
Thank you, Mr. McKesson. Our next candidate is Calvin Young. He's an engineer.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Calvin Young. It would be a privilege and an honor to serve you as the next mayor of Baltimore. Our city is in a state of emergency. We've recently had 344 homicides. We face a $75 million budget deficit, and over a quarter of our citizens live in poverty. When I walk the streets of Baltimore, it's clear to me, as it is to many, that we are in need of new, fresh leadership for the future of our city. I was born and raised in Northeast Baltimore to a mother who was a 22-year veteran of the city jails. I went to Poly, studying mechanical engineering at New York University before going to Harvard Business School and working at the White House. I've worked as the national chairperson, also of the National Society of Black Engineers, so I've helped thousands of young people be excited and exposed to engineering. So education is very important to me. The difference between me and other candidates is they'll talk about the past and ask why. And I'll ask you about the future and ask why not. Why not? Vote for me, Calvin Young, as your next mayor for Baltimore City. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Young. Our next candidate is Elizabeth Embry. She's the chief of the criminal division in the Maryland Attorney General's office.
Thank you. I'm proud of this city. It's a city where I grew up, where I went to public school, and where I spent my career. I've served as deputy state's attorney in the New York City Department of Housing, at the Maryland Department of Labor, and in City Hall. I'm now the chief of the criminal division at the Maryland Attorney General's office. So I've seen it all, inside and out, what works, what doesn't. I've witnessed what fuels progress, and also how easy it is for progress to stall without the right leadership. I'm running for mayor because we can be better. I'm running for mayor to end the violence, to make our schools stronger, to expand our economy, and hold our government accountable to the citizens of Baltimore. Every election is important. But this election in particular holds an opportunity for real change. I believe we can do things differently. I believe we can be safe. I believe we can expand our economy. I believe we can have schools that serve our children, that serve all our children. And I believe that we can have an ethical and efficient government, because the alternative is unacceptable. The alternative is a government that is mired in corruption and waste and old politics. And the choice is clear. Elizabeth Embry for mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Embry. Our next candidate is Carl Stokes. He is on the Baltimore City Council.
Thank you to the National Federation of the Blind and the six communities who invited us this evening. Really appreciate that. I've come back to City Council in the last 5 years after being away from city politics for 15 years. And while I was out, I did start a school for boys. I'm a small business guy, but a nonprofit school for boys, 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. We're not doing a great job for our kids. I want to talk about that a little bit later in the day. When I came back, I was asked to vote on closing 15 rec centers, 6 pools, closing the hours of everything else. I asked, why would we do that? They said we didn't have enough money. I went over to Rec and Parks and said, give me some books. Let me see the financials. Let me see your last 3 audits. They said, we don't do audits. We don't keep books. We don't do financials. Amazing. I put a law into the city council that said we have to audit the books of all our agencies, and that failed, but I came back, and now we're going to audit 13 of our agencies. I'll talk more about accountability and making sure that we determine where your dollars are efficiently. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Stokes. Our next candidate is Gershon Cupid. He is a sergeant in the Baltimore City Police Department.
Good evening. How are you? My name is Gershon Cupid. I'm running for mayor because I care. Yesterday, my son died, and it was hard for me to come tonight, but my wife told me that I need to go and continue what I started. So I'm here tonight because I care. I care about Baltimore City. Like Patrick said, he wanted a city where his kids can grow up and, you know, be here for it to be a better place. We have a lot of issues in Baltimore City, but we don't have a lot of people that actually care. I'm running because I care. The road seems hard, difficult, almost impossible. Whether I win or not, I will continue to fight because I care. My name is Gershon Cupid. I'm running for mayor of Baltimore. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cupid, and we all extend to you and your family our heartfelt condolences.
Thanks, Tom.
Our next candidate is Wilton Wilson. He is a nurse practitioner.
Thank you. My name is Wilton Wilson. I'm from Jamaica. I moved to this city in 1997 to go to school at Johns Hopkins, which I accomplished a bachelor's degree in nursing and moved on to get a nurse practitioner from Bowie State University. Since I came here, the idea is to just get the education and leave the city. But I fell in love with this city. And from that time to now, I noticed the city has been going downhill. And all I can see is the same politicians in power. And so we need to change the leadership in this city if we need to turn this city around. I strongly believe that this city is at risk to be run by the state. And I think that we are capable in this city to run this city. And we can't have the state take over this city. My name is Wilton Wilson. I'm running for mayor of this city. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Our next candidate is David Warnock. He is the founder and CEO of Camden Partners.
I'm David Warnock, and I extend my condolences to a really good man. Just the most important election of a generation. I have a plan for the city. I came to the city 33 years ago in that pickup truck that you see on TV. It's an inclusive plan where obstacles to one's potential do not get in the way of people achieving their life's dreams. It's a plan where we end the culture of low expectations that has held this city back for too long. For 76 years, the NFB has raised expectations with people with disabilities over the whole country. We need a mayor and a city that does that for the people that live here. If you remember 3 things about me tonight, remember I'm about jobs and opportunity. I'm about real change, and I deliver on my promises. I will deliver on my promises to build an inclusive, prosperous Baltimore. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Warnock. Our next candidate is Sheila Dixon. She is the former mayor.
Thank you, and my prayers are with you and your family, Sergeant Cooper.
Thank you.
I was born and raised here in Baltimore. Some people think they know me, some people don't. But let me say this. As mayor of this city, I have been able to reduce the crime in over 30 years. I was able to get our agencies up and running and functioning in a manner that was professional, that provided quality service to really move this city forward. I'm proud because this area that we stand by is a development that my administration worked with the community to make this happen. And as we move forward, I raised my son and daughter in this city. I love this city. We have every ingredient to be successful in Baltimore, but it's how do we connect neighborhoods and communities to work together with city government. And the reason why I'm rolling up my sleeves and I'm moving forward and staying very focused is because I have various plans that I have implemented that I'd like to share with you as we move forward.
Thank you, Ms. Dixon. So now we'll begin with our questions for the first six candidates. Again, these questions have been developed by the six neighborhood associations in this area, along with people from the National Federation of the Blind, with the cooperation of the League of Women Voters. Councilman Mosby, there are approximately 30,000 vacant properties in the city of Baltimore, about 16,000 houses and 14,000 or so vacant lots. What is your proposal to address this very serious health, economic, and public safety issue, and how will you plan to fund it?
So 2 months ago, I released a plan called Connecting the Dots. It's a comprehensive plan that talks about the biggest challenges here facing the city of Baltimore. One, we understand is blight in our community. And what we have to do is have a comprehensive plan for the city of Baltimore, not a plan that just looks out over 4 or 5 or 6 years, but a plan that really has objectable goals for the next 20 years. And that's by building off of our strengths. When I moved back to Baltimore from undergrad, I purchased a house that was dilapidated and abandoned for over 20 years. The houses across the street were in the same condition. But the reason I purchased there was because of Geordie Hill Park was my backyard. It had access to multimodal transportation and universities and to the central business district downtown. We have to start doing a better job of developing a comprehensive plan and building off of our strengths. We do that by lowering property taxes. We do that by providing tax abatement opportunities in some of our communities that have not seen investment. We do that by providing tax incentives in those communities as well. It's going to take a concerted effort and a collective effort, but there has to be a comprehensive plan. There has been a plan out there, Project 5000, to sell and city-owned properties efficiently to now vacants the value. And a lot of times what we do is we take a scarcity of funds and we throw them around the entire city. What we need now more than ever is a way to develop a concerted effort where, again, we're building off our strengths through capital improvement plan money, through a consortium of developers, but really developing a true comprehensive plan that maps out the city of Baltimore, not just a plan that maps out a plan for 4 or 5 years.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Your plan for vacants in the city of Baltimore.
To me, the vacants represent an excellent opportunity to do many things for the city. First and foremost is to remove the blight that has an effect on people who see that every single day, on their self-esteem, on their self-worth, and on their ability to live productive lives. We also have an opportunity to use that to put people to work. There are companies right now that have the ability to go into vacants and dismantle them and rebuild them back up. They are looking for staff. We have people all around the city who are eager to put in a good day's work. They just need the training, they need the tools, and they need someone to believe in them. So if we can find a way to pull those things together, which is going to be one of the main focuses of my plan on vacants, then we'll be able to start to not only address the problem of the blight, but put people to work at the same time. And by making sure that we have an efficient, competent, run city government, we're going to attract more people to stay here. That's going to result in more income taxes and more property tax revenue, which we can then use to fund programs like this. So the vacants, I don't see so much as a problem. I see it as an opportunity, and one that if we take full advantage of, we can use to our advantage. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Ms. Walsh, your plan for vacant housing in Baltimore.
If your plan is to rebuild all of the surrounding communities, that will bring an attention to those vacant lots and houses. My plan is to go in. We're not going to outsource jobs. We're going to put the citizens who live in the communities busy with small jobs, doing the demolition, doing the debris recycling, doing the rehabbing of houses so that they can live in those houses. So we're going to create the home ownership, we're going to create the small jobs, and we're going to create a local economy in each community. When you do that, you're going to create, as he said, a tax base that's going to be, that has been missing for so many decades. But I want to emphasize, when people say, how can you do that? Again, if you rebuild oversight and accountability, if you take a look at all of the kinds of contracts that the city has, the TIFs, the corporate subsidy, the enterprise zones, and how they're used, you can add $1 billion or $2 billion to our budget a year, because there's that much that's missing that can be brought out to our communities, and I will do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Walsh. Mr. McKesson, your plan for vacant housing in Baltimore.
So I think about this in four buckets, and the first is understanding that one of the challenges with vacant renovations is that often the price of, when we renovate houses, that the cost of the renovation actually exceeds the value of the house once it's renovated. So some of that is making sure that we have a strategy to renovate blocks. We've seen that in the city, in the City Arts neighborhood in Greenmount, and that's one strategy that we've seen being really effective. When I think about the other parts, the second is making sure that we have an investment strategy that is focused just not on teardowns, but rebuilds. So when we think about the governor's plan, it's a teardown strategy. It's not actually a rebuild strategy, and that is part of the work, making sure that we clear space, but it's not a rebuild. So part of the rebuild has to be about vacancy to value and strengthening programs like that, making sure that we're intentional about partnerships. The resources exist in the city, the strategy doesn't exist. So how can we be intentional about building green space, building entertainment, and thinking about development beyond housing? And then the fourth bucket is thinking about development beyond